Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sabrina Kofer, and on behalf of Choice and ACRL, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, How Can Dissertation Citation Networks Accelerate Discovery, which is sponsored by ProQuest, part of Clarivate. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from Choice and ACRL that addresses new ideas and developments of interest to the academic library community. Before we get started, I'd like to point out just a few features of the webinar software. All of the attendees who join the presentation are automatically muted and your cameras are off, so don't worry about generating any noise or feedback. We've got that taken care of for you. In the main area of the screen, you can follow along with the presentation materials. We are using the Q&A feature today. Please use it to ask questions of our presenters. We'll answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the presentation, so please do type your questions into the Q&A box as they occur to you. Also note that there is closed captioning available for today's session. To toggle the automated captions on or off, please use the CC button on the bottom right corner of your screen. Last, please note that we are recording today's program and everyone who registered should receive a follow-up email with a link to the archive version. And with that, we are ready to get started. So I will pass it over to Jess.
Hi, thank you very much. I'm so happy to have everyone attending today. My name is Jess Byrne. I am from ProQuest, part of Clarivate. I'm a senior product marketing manager, and I'm happy to welcome everyone to one of our first presentations since ProQuest has become a part of Clarivate. We've come together to put this, this content together for you today, and we'll be connecting on the topic of how can dissertations citation networks accelerate discovery. We're going to go through the benefits of what a citation index can do, how does it work, how is it beneficial, and why we're looking to expand it into dissertations. And we're going to do a demo about a little bit, show you how that functions today, a citation functionality within dissertations, and also how you as librarians can help your students and faculty use these tools for their work. So I'm really pleased to have these speakers on today. We're joined by David Pendlebury, Head of Research Analysis at the Institute for Scientific Information. Since 1983, he has used the Web of Science data to study the structure and dynamics of research. He worked for many years with ISI founder Eugene Garfield, and with Henry Small, David developed the Web of Science Essential Science Indicators. So extremely knowledgeable. We're very happy to have him. And Angela DiAgostino is the Vice President of Product Management for the dissertations portfolio. Since taking on the role in 2019, she's led the team on expanding the number of international partners, adding universities from over 20 countries and developing a range of tools to improve researcher efficiency. So welcome and thank you. I'm going to pass this on to David to get us started. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jess. Members of the ACRL will, of course, be quite knowledgeable about indexing, cataloging, and searching the scientific and scholarly literature. What we're offering today is just an update on the recent work at Clarivate about a new feature in the ProQuest Dissertations and Theses Global Database called Citation Connections, and that supports information retrieval. As just said, I was invited to speak with you today because for many years I worked with Eugene Garfield, the father of citation indexing for sciences. He recognized the potential and power of citations, that is, cited references, in the literature to join closely related publications, finding information through common themes, methods, or ideas. May I have the next slide? Garfield's 1955 paper in Science introduced citation indexing to the scientific community. But citation indexing had long been used in the legal literature, in fact, since 1873, in an index called Shepard Citations. Shepard's indexed citations to cases and statutes, allowing a user to discover whether a court had overturned, reaffirmed, or questioned a previous ruling. In the 1950s, Garfield was struggling with the problem of automating the indexing of the literature. Publications were, if you can believe it, rapidly increasing, and the traditional indexing process using subject descriptors, keywords, and the so-called controlled vocabulary method were not keeping up. He realized that recording cited references in a paper linked that item precisely to previously published literature, related publications, because these cited references embedded the knowledge, the expertise, and the judgment of the authors of the citing papers. He called these authors his army of indexers. And the Science Citation Index, which was first issued commercially in 1964, an Association of Ideas Index. In a citation index, the search begins with a publication of interest, and then one moves backward in time through the cited references or forward to the citing papers. This is sometimes called citation cycling as a method of information retrieval. May I have the next slide? A method using cited references to find the most similar documents to the one of interest was described in 1963 by Mike Kessler of MIT. And this technique is called bibliographic coupling. The idea is very simple. If two documents share many of the same cited references, their content, themes, methods, ideas, is likely very similar. This graphic on the right shows that A and B are related because both cited C, D, and E. The frequency of shared cited references is then a proxy measure of similarity and strength of association. You may be familiar that in the Web of Science, we show in the source record for each indexed item, the number of times it's cited, and the number of cited references in the document. You can click on those numbers to see the citing papers and the cited references. There is also a link in the lower right to something called related records. And related records is a list of items that are strongly associated with the source record you're looking at through bibliographic coupling. The items that are related records are ranked by the number of shared cited references. Using related records, as well as all the citing and cited items and links, will help you expand a search efficiently. May I have the next slide? The measure of similarity among documents obtained through examining bibliographic coupling can be used to map documents in two or more dimensions as proximity. In this illustration, bibliographic coupling has been used to associate related papers in the field of life history theory. Not only are the papers ordinated by strength of bibliographic coupling, but they are also clustered and color-coded by these measures. A visualization allows for search and discovery of a different and dynamic type, a more interactive process than simply scanning a list of papers, even a list ranked by relevancy. More and more, visualization will be a common information retrieval method, perhaps the most common, because of its intuitive and multidimensional character. Finally, I would mention that ISI was the pioneer in the field of citation, science mapping through citation, through the work of Henry Small, our former chief scientist. He explored bibliographic coupling and introduced the related concept of document association through co-citation as long ago as 1973. And with that, I'll pass over to Angela.
Thank you, David. I had to find the mute button. Thanks very much. Thank you all for being here today. So as David was saying, for many decades, the Web of Science has been applying these techniques to journal articles, books, and other content types. These solutions have brought researchers many efficiencies and insights that focus their search experience. The power of citation networks is that they uncover clusters of information not discoverable with standard keyword or subject searches to identify similarity. For some works that have no shared terminology, the use of citations expands the opportunity to find relationships that would never have been found otherwise. So for all of these reasons, we wanted to apply the use of this technology to dissertations and theses content. By applying citation indexing to dissertations and theses, so much more research can be uncovered, much of which has gone undiscovered because it hasn't been published elsewhere. When looking at the acceptance rates of top-tier journal publishers, you can see how difficult it is for researchers to be published, which probably comes as no surprise to you. What may be of surprise, though, is that we've seen studies that estimate only about 25% of research published in dissertations are published in other scholarly publishing channels. As a result, a significant amount of research is outside the coverage of databases that concentrate on indexing scientific and scholarly journals, which means potentially important insights and innovations are overlooked. This is especially important for younger investigators who need to discover what's been done to ensure they don't duplicate research. The dissertations and theses literature is also important for all researchers to examine because it often represents the leading edge of current investigations. This is why dissertations are essential to a comprehensive 360-degree view of a particular research area. To highlight a timely example of this, we know marginalized groups of people have been excluded from publishing opportunities throughout history. In many of these instances, their dissertation is the only record of their contributions to their field. This is the case with the example on the left. Here we see a group of women of color who earned their doctorates in psychology and made important contributions to their field, yet their work can't be found in current textbooks or other publications. ProQuest is sponsoring a project headed up by researchers at Pacific Lutheran University and Georgia State University. Authors and researchers are capturing the early psychological research contribution from women of color in a supplemental text for their current curriculum. It aims to spotlight research from women of color who earned PhDs in the United States prior to 1980, when their work was not fully considered because of systematic racism. The completed book project is planned to be published by the end of 2022. The chapters will summarize the women's dissertations, including a reproducibility critique, evaluating the research transparency of their work, discuss the historical context, interpret their work through an alternative approach, and make suggestions about how to use the material in courses. In the other example here, Dr. Lady J documents drag performance history in her dissertation. This is the first compilation of drag contributions and influences to performance trends. Although she would like to turn this into a book someday, finding the right platform and funding is a slow process, and she is grateful that she is able to make her work available now through her dissertation. Dissertations are one of the most commonly used data sources for text and data mining projects conducted by faculty and researchers. Professors such as Dr. Weinberg appreciate having such a large, normalized, and global data set available to them, which saves an enormous amount of time while they glean insights into research and education trends, career outcomes, and more. In Dr. Piggott's use case, full data sets are rarely included in journal articles. Shorter articles normally only contain the statistically significant data. She reviews the full data sets found in dissertations in order to avoid publishing outcome bias in her future work and the work of her students. So in order to tap into dissertations and theses as a resource for discovery, the full text needs to be aggregated in one place with equitable discoverability. It also needs to be global, multidisciplinary, multilingual, multicultural. PQDT Global brings all of this together. With the partnerships we have around the world, we are fortunate to have the opportunity to build connections that improve our researchers' work. Next, we'd like to talk to you about how the library can help graduate students with their challenges and how they can use dissertations to conduct efficient, effective discovery. Through our research, we found these to be the top challenges that students encounter that dissertations can help with. As librarians, you already know that dissertations can help with these problems, but explaining how to leverage them was previously complex. What do your researchers need to be successful? They need to be experts in their fields. To do this, they need comprehensive knowledge that includes diverse perspectives. They need to be effective, analyzing and choosing the right research to follow. They need to be efficient and work quickly in order to respond to urgent challenges. And they need to be exceptional, delivering their own novel research outcomes. Here's an example of what these researchers are faced with. In 2020, researchers were met with an urgent research need in COVID-19, and they experienced an information overload. In the first 5 months alone, 15,000 scholarly articles on the topic were published, and during that full year, 24,000 dissertations were published. Researchers need an efficient and effective way of navigating and consuming this information. As David has said to us, the only solution to information overload is precise information retrieval. By leveraging a citation network for dissertations, helping your students extract value from dissertations is easier, more straightforward, and will help them uncover new connections. Now available in over 1 million full-text records within PQDT, we recently released our new citation connections, which deliver on the bibliographic coupling that David mentioned earlier. The cited references in these titles are extracted and measured against 1 billion other known citations to identify shared cited references. The greater the number of shared cited references, the higher probability that the two papers are strongly related. Now let's take a deeper look at how we've applied the citation knowledge graph technology to dissertations, moving from left to right, 1 to 4 there. By leveraging the already rich citation data that ProQuest has been investing in over the years, a seed dissertation document includes many hyperlinked cited papers. Through bibliographic coupling, a neighborhood of up to 1,000 documents is identified. The neighborhood is any other source that contains at least 5 cited sources in common. Foundational research, then, is a list of records from a neighborhood of related sources that cite at least 5 documents cited by the seed document displayed on the page. Foundational research records are ranked according to the frequency with which they are cited by documents in the neighborhood. This collection can be useful when building a foundational understanding of a topic or when selecting a topic for a research project. The assumption behind foundational research is that the more cited references 2 documents share, the closer the subject relationship, and the most frequently cited sources in a subject area are part of the core knowledge in that topic. Similar dissertations, then, is a list of dissertations and theses that cite at least 5 documents cited by the seed document. Similar dissertations records are ranked according to the number of cited sources they share in common with the seed dissertation. Again, the assumption behind similar dissertations is that documents that cite the same works have a subject relationship. The more cited sources that are shared between the 2 documents, the closer the subject relationship. Now I'd like to show you a little bit of this in action. Oh, my session almost ended, just made it in time. So I noticed in looking at the ACRL registrant list that one of our partners, the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, was planning to attend. I'm not sure if she's here today, but I thought I'd show an example from this university. So I did a search, a preset search here on the University of Jerusalem. And if we go to the first record here, towards cell therapy in progressive multiple sclerosis, we come to actually our new e-learning modules. This is another tips you can share with your students For those novice researchers who might not know what a dissertation is or how to use it, these are interactive tools for them to use and to, at their leisure, to understand what exactly a dissertation is and how to use it. So that I encourage you to check those out and have your students work through those. So you can dismiss that after the first time it appears. So you'll see the full record here, which in this case is actually in Hebrew. Again, multicultural, multilingual. And we've extracted since 2008 forward, we've been extracting the cited references from the bibliographies of dissertations. So you can click on the references to see the full list of 211, in this case, cited references on this document, hyperlinked where we have the content to link to on the platform. And this is the core data set then, these cited references that we've been extracting close to 150 million over the past 12 years or so, that form the core data set that we use to build the technology graph. So going back to the abstract and details, although the dissertation itself is in Hebrew, you can see the title in Hebrew here, we also have the title in English and the abstract in English for cross-searchability across multiple languages. And you can see the full list of subject areas here, again, which may or may not be included in the cited references to find connections through there. So if we look on a right-hand panel, then is our foundational research on this topic. And there are little information bubbles here that you can click on if people aren't sure what exactly does this mean. There's also an explanation of what the seed document is that users can click on. And this is saying this particular article has been cited over 1,000 times. And this is the number of documents within the ProQuest databases that have cited this particular source. A user can then click on the content, and depending on the access rights of the library, in this case, this particular journal article is available on the ProQuest platform. It's from the New England Journal of Medicine. But it's important to note that these references, these foundational sources, are not limited to what ProQuest aggregates. This is anything that is cited within these dissertations. And whether you, depending on the library's holdings and how your link resolver is set up, the user will then be granted access to the content. So the foundational research panel delivers back the top five ranked sources, again, journal articles, books, or other content types related to this topic. And then you can click on the See More button here to see additional sources related to this topic. And again, this really forms an important kicking off, starting point, jumpstart point for the research to uncover the most relevant articles and papers on their particular topic. Going down to the bottom of the screen then, there's a carousel for the similar dissertations panel. And again, you'll see the top five listed here, and then you can click on see more similar dissertations. And what's interesting to note here is that there are similar dissertations related, again, this is the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, is the seed document. And we're seeing similar dissertations coming from universities in Germany here. I won't attempt to pronounce this. I'm Julius Maximus in Germany. We have McGill University in Canada. We have Harvard, Georgetown, UCLA. So a real global connection to the Hebrew University. Really great way to uncover potential collaboration, other pockets of research that are happening around the world in your particular area. I also noted out of the 20 similar dissertations, four were done at the State University of New York at Buffalo, all by the same advisor, who's also happens to be an advisor and listed in the Web of Science as an author. So for faculty members, for students who may be looking for experts in the field to research and uncover what else is happening, a great way to make those connections as well. See if there's anything else. I just want to refer to my notes really quickly here. I think those were the highlights. So I do encourage you to please, for those of you who have a PQDT Global subscription, please go in now that it is available now, play around with that, and please do let us know what you think. So back to my presentation. So just to recap there, then the citation connection features can be found along the bottom on the right-hand column of the found seed dissertation. And this is where you'll find the use of the bibliometric coupling that David described, which will help enable global cross-cultural connections that may not have otherwise been discovered. Similar Dissertations is delivering a full list of dissertation titles that share citations and references with the currently selected dissertation. This feature is particularly valuable for new dissertation authors that need to contribute new research to the field and confidently understand what has already been produced. Foundational research can be used to more quickly locate the relevant and influential sources on a topic, going beyond dissertations to recommend articles, books, and more. One thing I did forget to point out, that first foundational article in that list for the multiple sclerosis seed document from the New England Journal of Medicine was actually published in 1998. And there were over 1,000 other documents that had cited it as recently as 2021. So to David's point about citing papers, that future view of what the continuation of that trajectory of that research continues well beyond that initial research document. So as librarians, you already know that dissertations can help with these key challenges students face. And now with these new tools, we've made it easier for you to help your students become more effective and efficient in their research. By identifying the most relevant research in the field, by ensuring their research is unique, and for the novice researcher, by quickly locating relevant sources for their assignments. The vision of the future of PQDT Global is to harness the power of the Web of Science, offering our users unparalleled data-driven insights into the discoveries hidden within unpublished graduate research. Citation Connections is just the first step towards achieving this vision, with more citation enhancements in the coming years. Again, we encourage you to please use the links that you see here to request a trial or a demo if you're interested in learning more. And I want to thank you very much for joining us today. I hope you found this useful, and I'll turn it back over to Jess for the Q&A session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Angela. That was wonderful. Thanks for sharing all that. So I'm going to look to some of the Q&A that has come in here. And a couple questions popping in. One of the questions I'm seeing is, why isn't the Citation Connections available through regular ProQuest? From Christine. Angela, do you want to address that? I think.
Yes. So thanks, Christine. We've started with dissertations contents. Great question. And we've talked about this and definitely plan to extend it to beyond dissertations to the rest of the ProQuest platform. But frankly, it was easier to start with dissertations because we have a unique corpus of cited references, again, that we've been extracting since 2008. And we have some gaps in some of our coverage with some of the other content types on the ProQuest platform, but it is our goal to extend the citation connections to more than just dissertations in the future.
Yeah, and I think it's maybe helpful to note that these citation connections are found within our ProQuest Dissertations and Theses Global collections. So they aren't an additional charge or anything like that. They come with that platform, that subscription.
And I do emphasize it is obviously connecting the user to other content within the ProQuest platform. So even though you may not find the citation connections within ABI Inform, for example, or ProQuest Central, you are being directed to that content from that seed document.
Great. And I've got one from Kate. David, maybe you can help answer this one. She says, slightly nerdy technical question. So we'll try to help you with this, Kate. If we can't, we'll get back to you. But she is asking, can you speak a bit about the process that's matching citations with slightly different styles or mistakes? How strong is that in terms of matching citations?
Well, I can speak on the ISI side of that rather than the ProQuest side. As I mentioned, the first Science Citation Index was released commercially in 1964. So over the years, we have had a lot of experience in dealing with variation in the way that items are cited. And depending upon the technology at the time, we implemented different solutions and different algorithms. But I can say that over the decades, it's improved considerably. And when we've seen variations in particular kinds of citation referencing mistakes, we tried to build those into the algorithm. So over time, the matching of citations to the formal source record has gotten much, much better. It's not perfect, but it is much better. I can't really speak for my colleagues about how they've dealt with that in the dissertations database, but I imagine it's somewhat similar.
Yeah, thank you, David.
To that either. We'll need to get an expert to comment on that, unfortunately.
Yeah, we can always dig into that with our developers too. And thank you, Kate, so much for that question. Douglas asks, he says, ProQuest already has a fantastic data mining platform available with TDM Studio. And PQDT is included in that tool. Will this be an integration into that system?
So not at this point. I think that we are talking about enabling the cited reference extraction, text and data mining of cited references within TDM Studio. But this actual kind of user experience at this point, we're not contemplating including it in TDM Studio, but would love to hear if that would be valuable to our users.
Great question, Douglas, thank you. And Rebecca asks, how long does it take for the references of new theses and dissertations to be added to the database? I see that the most recent ones are available. But some don't have the citation links yet.
Yes, that's a great question. There is a bit of a delay in the processing of the data. So several months, unfortunately, we are working through that to try to accelerate that flow through because of the amount of curation and work that goes into extracting them, normalizing them, correcting them and linking them, frankly, doing all of the backend technology work, there is some delay, but we are working on accelerating that process.
Thanks, Angela. I have one question from Christine. She says that they often steer students away from dissertations because they aren't considered peer-reviewed sources. So telling them to go to a dissertation database is going to be strange. How do you propose changing directions on this?
That's a great question. So, you know, it's interesting. It's really, it really comes down to, we've had lots of interviews with librarians and faculty members, and there seems to be a division on this. Most of our customers obviously will direct their students to dissertations. They understand the value. And I think our e-learning modules are also helping to address where the dissertation fits within the scholarly research ecosystem. So as far as, you know, not being peer reviewed. It is sort of peer reviewed by the faculty and the committee members, and we only publish in PQDT Global dissertations and theses that from accredited universities. So they are valid pieces of research. So I think that David, unless you have other thoughts about how to kind of position where a dissertation fits within the scholarly ecosystem, I'd love to hear your thoughts about this. Oh, you're on mute, David.
Sorry. One could always check the extent to which a particular dissertation is cited. That might mean that you look in the Web of Science. Certainly, citations to dissertations are in the minority compared to journal articles, proceedings, even books, but you'd get some indication of the degree to which somebody thinks that the information is reliable or even authoritative. Maybe Angela, you could speak to the future in which, you know, we are imagining that this citation, these different citation networks are all brought together to make this kind of analysis much easier.
Yeah, that's a great point, David. We are envisioning integrating the dissertations with Web of Science in the future, and certainly bringing together the cited reference technology and an analysis. And I think that to David's point, kind of being able to draw those connections between the initial work and the subsequent work is also something that we aspirationally, the direction we would like to go to, so you can see the impact, overall impact of that particular work. But I think, you know, cautioning perhaps that it's not peer reviewed in the traditional academic publishing channel notion, but as we saw in some of the examples, that doesn't mean there isn't valid very important, useful research that should be read within these dissertations. So I think, you know, kind of a wholesale approach to just don't read them because they're not peer reviewed is missing a significant body of work that the students should be exposed to. And in fact, we've heard examples of, you know, undergraduates who the only piece of literature they can find on a particular topic was in a dissertation. You know, the example that we love to share is the, you know, the history of the Spider-Man costume. You know, who knew? There's actually a dissertation on that. So, you know, it's better than Google or a blog or finding something on TikTok. You know, it's a little bit more heavily vetted and researched for that student to use in their particular assignment.
Thank you both. And Karen also offers a bit of advice here in the chat. And she says, if it helps, we will sometimes advise students to use the dissertation database as a gateway to finding other peer-reviewed sources rather than a peer-reviewed source in and of itself. So it could be valid for different purpose. And I think she's really leaning toward where the foundational research feature we offer could really benefit them, is they don't need to cite that dissertation necessarily in their assignments or work, but all of the journal articles, books that surface through that feature might be really important information they should be reading.
Yeah, and that's an excellent point. In fact, one of the reasons that students and faculty resist dissertations is because they're very long. Nobody wants to read 300 pages on the history of Spider-Man. But you can get right to, you know, these tools are exactly what you need to get right to the sources, as Karen was saying, the peer-reviewed sources that I need for my, so think of it as a tool rather than a piece of literature to read yourself.
Yeah, and John writes in here, I'm gonna just quote him. He says, heck, it may impact a form of peer review. So, I mean, I think we can, I know it's a big discussion point a lot of people have, so. Oh, great. So I know there's a lot of questions in here. Let me see. There is one question, Paul, I may need to get back to you on that It says, can you speak to possibly exporting the results of using this resource to programs like Zotero or Mendeley? I'm unsure if we can answer that today, but we will get back to you on that particular question. Let's see, we have one from Barbara. How might a user search for and find relevant dissertations from other schools of thought or theoretical approaches that would have a minimal number of citations in common? Any advice here?
I'm not sure I'm understanding the question.
David, do you have any thoughts on that particular?
Well, yeah, in terms of normative behavior, in terms of citation, generally it's neutral to take account of previous publications, or positive in the sense of building upon previous work. That's the typical pattern in the sciences. In the humanities and social sciences, it gets a little bit more complicated, as implied, because sometimes you're dealing with, as mentioned, schools of thought. And in that case, the number of contrasting citations, we can say, might actually increase. And a citation is a connection to show association, not necessarily approval. So I think that it can be mined to find contrasting schools of thought that in fact helps to answer the question being raised. Not always, but often. And the citation network is very useful for not only its direct connections, but sometimes indirect associations. So moving from a center hub and doing that citation circling, moving forward and backward in time, I think that you could find a connection, even if relatively weak, with a differing school of thought.
Interesting question, Barbara, thank you. And Christine asks, what are the e-learning modules that you mentioned earlier? Angela, would you like to go a little bit more into detail on those?
Sure. So we have actually two sets. I should say we have a set of graduate students that we released during the pandemic that were kind of dissertations boot camp. And these were real. These were written in partnership with a faculty member at Cornell who holds several boot camps per year. And obviously when things had to go virtual, we worked with her on four different modules on, you know, kind of developing your writing plan and staying organized, especially in a virtual environment. The e-learning modules that I was sharing today are geared a little bit more towards the novice researcher, undergraduate or graduate student just starting out. And this is to help explain what is a dissertation. Again, for that use case where it's the only thing I found in my discovery engine, what is this thing and how do I use it? And kind of help guide them to exactly what we've been describing. You don't have to read 300 pages to get value out of this piece of content. So there are four different modules. They will pop up when a user first comes upon a dissertation within the platform. And again, they can dismiss it, or it's always on the left-hand panel that they, and it's called Dissertations Demystified, you know, kind of help them to explain what they are and how to best use them in their research. And we're happy to set up a demo to walk you through that if you would like.
Thank you, Angela. We have here, will citations to passages from books be included among the citations and links to articles? Asking for a friend in the humanities. That comes from John. So I think he's asking about references within the passages, not necessarily references in the reference pages of books.
Right. Not at this time. We are looking at what's being referenced within the bibliography. So the cited reference to the book, not the citations within the content itself. That we're not working on quite yet.
Okay. Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Angela. And maybe we can address just one more question. And it was in relation to the Web of Science and in future integrations with ProQuest dissertations and theses. Will the citation network of dissertations be integrated at some point with the Web of Science?
Yes, that's definitely the plan. Don't have a time frame yet for you. We're in the early stages of defining the integration between the content sets to start, the metadata and abstracts of the dissertations with the Web of Science database. But the cited reference, the network, citation network will be a part of the longer term plan to integrate for sure.
Great. I would just add that, one subject that we only briefly talked about is the avoidance of duplication of research. And I think that that's a key element in doing a search in the Web of Science or in the ProQuest dissertations database. But this has been a problem for a long time. You would think that all the information resources would make this problem go away more and more, and yet it is persistent. I think having the two citation networks integrated will do a lot to help younger and older researchers avoid duplication of research.
Definitely, yes. I have one question in here about with the popularity of institutional repositories. How are you encouraging students to participate? Are there concerns? What are the numbers like of what's being included in the ProQuest database?
So typically universities and authors will deposit within their university's institutional repository as well as within PQDT. So it's been sort of a complementary discovery channel. And we have been recently including also for some universities a link to the institutional repository as well to increase the awareness of that content available on the IR as well. But bringing, again, the multicultural, international, the global perspective, having a one-stop shop has been enormously valuable for both the end user who's using PQDT Global and the faculty and researcher who's using the Text and Data Mining Studio to be able to conduct research in one place. So I think there's still, and has always been, a really strong use case for that, the aggregation model, I don't see that stopping anytime soon.
Yeah, and there, I think he's also asking some questions about perhaps the embargoes here. So which ProQuest does honor all author wishes and embargoes. So there shouldn't be any concern regarding that.
Yes, in fact, we're going to be releasing this year on the platform when the embargo will be lifted. So we'll have the metadata record right now. So right now the experience is you get the metadata record and the abstract, but the full text is under embargo. Now we're going to also be posting the date when that embargo will be lifted, so they'll know when they can access the full text as well. It's been requested by our customers.
Loving all these questions. It's wonderful. I have one from Velma. It says, in your experience, what is the best way to explain the notice on some records? Says this title is not available for view or purchase. What is the percentage of this type of record in the database? Okay, I think she's also discovering some of the embargoed titles.
Yeah, that's a great segue. So I think ideally that date will help that problem. So you'll see it, but that's usually a title that's under embargo. So once the user will see the date that it's under embargo and when that will be become available, should address that concern and issue.
Wonderful. Thank you, everyone. I think we've reached the end of our question list here, unless we get a few more. But if we didn't address your questions, we'll take all these questions back and get back to you. And thank you so much for attending today. I'm going to hand it back over to Sabrina, who will close us out today.
Great. Thanks so much, Jess. And thanks so much to David and Angela for taking the time to present for us today. And thank you, Jess, for moderating the Q&A. And thanks to our attendees for your questions and comments. It was a really informative discussion. I'd like to remind our viewers that we did record today's program, so be on the lookout for a follow-up email from Choice and ACRL with a link to the recording. Also, if you have a few minutes after the presentation to fill out a brief survey, we'd really appreciate it. Your responses help improve our presentations. There's one from ProQuest as well that's in the chat, and then one that should pop up from us here at Choice. So thanks again to all of you out there for joining us. If you have any other questions, David and Angela's emails are on the slide. We hope you learned something new from the session, and we hope to see you again in the near future on another webinar.
Bye, thank you very much.
Thank you, bye-bye.